faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye, oh, come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Choirs of angels sing in exaltation. Oh, sing, all ye citizens of heaven above. Glory to God. All.
Light of the world, treasure. The stars in the wintry sky, joy of the Father reaching through darkness, shine across the earth, send the shadows to of time.
So the 4 weeks leading up to Christmas we call Advent, and this Sunday is the fourth week, because next Sunday is Christmas Day. In fact, this year, yes, Christmas Day falls on a Sunday. And some people are asking, were you having church? I'm like, yes, we are having church for Christ's Mass. It is a service honoring Jesus. In fact, Christmas originally in the Roman Catholic Church, that Mass or that Christmas service was usually a midnight Mass that led to the opening of Christmas Day and Christmas Eve. And here at the church at Maltby in Monroe, we love that kind of a tradition. We are not a Catholic church. We're part of the Assemblies of God. But we do have a beautiful Christmas service as well. And so what we do is on Christmas Eve at the Maltby campus, which is where we're at right now, we will have a 10 p.m. service, and we'd love to invite you to tune in for that, and we will broadcast that as well. We'll stream it on Christmas Day, however, but we'll have a beautiful candlelight service. We always call it Christmas by candlelight. My wife, Marjorie, or one of the kids ministers is going to do a sit around the stage here and read a Christmas story, and we'll have it on the screen as well, with kids in their PJs, and we'll have Christmas carols for our worship, and we'll do communion together, and we will do at the end of it, we'll end our Christmas carols by lighting candles together just to celebrate the coming of our Savior, and we will end that with Silent Night. And so I would really encourage you, if you can make it, would you make that a special opportunity? We know that many families have big Christmas Eve traditions, and some of you have big Christmas Day traditions, or Christmas morning traditions. In the Campbell House, we're big Christmas morning people. Some people are big Christmas Eve people. So what we're doing is Christmas Eve at 10 p.m. here at the Maltby campus, we will have a service for Christmas by candlelight. But if you're a big Christmas Eve person, then at our Monroe campus at 10:30, the regular service time, we will have a Christmas Day. It's the same service, so pick one, Christmas Eve or Christmas Day, that works for you. And we will not have a service at Maltby on Christmas Day. It's the same thing we're doing. We're just doing our Maltby service on Christmas Eve, and we're doing our Monroe service on Christmas morning. And we would love to invite you to see you here as a part of that. And yes, we will record and have that streaming for you next week. But I want to wish all of you a very Merry Christmas as well. Please stay safe. I know the weather's getting colder, and we have snow in the forecast. But I love this time of year. We have decorations, we have our poinsettias, we've got our Christmas wreaths, we got Christmas trees up, and all of that. And Christmas is full of traditions. In fact, at the Campbell House, at our house, my wife, yes, I'm gonna talk about my wife, Marjorie, my wife is amazing, and she has an absolute passion and love for manger scenes. Now, we don't have a giant manger scene like in our yard, but we have little manger scenes around our house. I mean, you might have a manger scene, and I have some pictures on the screen here, some of the manger scenes that we have. One of them is of Bolivia, and it looks like they're playing little flutes, and those are supposed to be the wise men, actually, from when we were missionaries in Bolivia. We have another one inside. It's a manger scene inside of a cactus. And that's from Mexico. We have some other beautiful manger scenes as well with the wise men, sometimes with a star, sometimes with the shepherds, but always definitely with Mary and baby Jesus. We even have some toy ones that we put that are at lower levels for kids they can play with and you don't have to worry about it. And everybody's got manger scenes, right? It's a normal Christmas tradition as part of the ornaments that we see. And it makes us remind us about what the reason for the season really is, and that is the birth of our Savior who came to die for the sins of the world to save you and for me. Something that's interesting, however, and this is how we're going to end our Advent season, is talking about one of the people or one of the groups of people who are expectedly waiting. Now, we've had Taproot Theater, and we've talked about the shepherds and all this other stuff, but in every manger scene that you notice at the Campbell House, and I would challenge you to look at your manger scenes, we always have three individuals, the wise men. Well, sometimes we call them the three kings, and some of ours have those as well. In fact, I think every one of them, of the six that we have, do double check those pictures. But do you notice that there's always three? And they usually have crowns. And I think it's interesting, but also it's important for us to realize the romanticized view of the three kings for our manger scenes. And we need to get back to the Bible, actually. Today, we're going to explore what the Bible says about some people who waited in expectation, which is what Advent actually means, is the waiting in expectation. The waiting of the coming is what it is. Is the pre before the coming, and that hope that comes with that, about these fascinating magi and their prophetic visit to the only king, actually, in that scene, which is Jesus. If you got your Bible, hold it up. Repeat after me and say, I love God's word. It feeds me, it guides me, and it directs me. Take that Bible, open it to the very beginning of the New Testament, to the book of Matthew. Last time I spoke, a couple weeks ago, I spoke on Matthew chapter 1. Well, let's continue on to Matthew chapter 2. First book in the New Testament, right in the kind of smack dab in the middle of your Bible, Matthew chapter 2. And we're going to read that together. And this is part of the Christmas story. This is the story of the Magi. It says this, Matthew chapter 1, and we're going to read verses 1 through 12 together, and I'm reading out of the NIV. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi, there they are, from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him. I'm sure this story is pretty familiar for you. When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed. I would think so, because he's the king, and they're asking, where's the king? And all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Christ was to be born, the Messiah, this promised Messiah we hear about in the Old Testament all of the time. In Bethlehem, Judea, they replied, for this is what the prophet has written. And they quote Micah chapter 5, verse 2. They say this, but you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will be the shepherd of my people Israel. Verse 7 says this, then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and make a careful search for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I too may go and worship him. After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed on coming to the house. They saw the child with his mother, Mary, and bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and of, mine says incense, it's frankincense, and of myrrh, it's a type of incense. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. Well, they realized that Herod was up to no good. Later on, we read that Herod tried to kill all of the boys there in verse, is about 16, I think. Yep, and it says, when he had When Herod, verse 16 says, when Herod realized that he had been outwitted by the Magi, he was furious and gave orders to kill all the boys in Bethlehem and its vicinity who were 2 years old and under, in accordance with the time he had learned from the Magi. So I want to share this. First of all, we're going to nerd out a little bit again. I get a little nerdy. I know you guys, some of you may like that, some of you may not, but I think that it's important, and I don't do it just to nerd out. I do it because sometimes there's significance that sometimes we overlook at the power of what's actually happening here. I don't want us to just gloss over this and go, oh, cool, it's the Christmas story, blah, 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 and move on. But there's something deep. There's something here for you and for me. So the question a lot of times is, who were these Magi? Well, even though the Christmas song says, we three kings of Orient are, it's beautiful, but it's not biblical. The three kings are not actually kings. The Bible never calls them kings, ever. They call us the word Magi. The word in the New Testament, and I got it on the screen for you, is Magoi. Magoi is the plural of Magos, and it's where we get the word Magi. It's where we get the word magistrate. It's where we get the word magician, even. Now, they're from the East and most likely the neighboring empire of Persia. And it means that they are great men or magnificent men. Do you see where that comes from? Now you're starting to get that root word. They're magnificent men of wisdom. And the term refers more not to magicians. The word magician comes from this idea, not this idea from magician, if that makes sense. But it's someone who has this wisdom and knowledge and ability to do cool things. And that's where we get that word from. But for the Persians, this word that they use even in the Greek when they talk about it, this is more like philosophers or scientists. Some translation even refer to them as wise men. That's the whole idea. From the word magi, we get the word magic as magicians, and because sometimes they would be able to tell, like say, oh, I can foretell the future like a fortune teller by studying the stars. You see, these magi were also astronomers. And because they would study the movement of stars, and they would study the stars and the movement of planets. Now you would think the movement of stars, but it's the earth that moves, not the stars. But planets move, and they saw a star or a heavenly body moving, which we see the Magi doing at the time of Jesus, but they were not into astrology, which gets into the occult. They were into astronomy. You see, astrology is like, what's your zodiac sign? Are you a Taurus? Are you a Scorpio? Are you a Leo? That's not biblical. That's like, ooh, because of the constellation that's the most prominent, the month that you're born and whatever hemisphere, blah, 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 blah. That means you're a this, and this means we can foretell all the, that's all garbage. Astronomy is when you study the movement of the stars and you can tell, hey, this is probably Jupiter, but they didn't know what planets were then. They didn't have telescopes and all these other things. So to them, all of them were stars. Well, to understand who these Magi really were, we need to go back a little bit in time in the Bible, about 600 years, and we're going to meet a guy by the name of Daniel. Now, if you're thinking Daniel in the lion's den, the answer is yes. That is the same Daniel. But this is a little after the whole lion's den thing. In Daniel chapter 2, Daniel is with the Persian king, or the Babylonian king at the time, and his name is King Nebuchadnezzar. Nebuchadnezzar had a dream in Daniel chapter 2, and he is really disturbed by this dream. In fact, this is actually a dream that God gave him. Now, not all dreams are dreams that God gave you. Sometimes you dream because you had pizza the night before and you had weird dreams because of, you know, whatever. Yeah, gas or whatever that was. Well, with this, God gave him a dream. And it really messed with him. Have you ever had a dream like where God just, like, maybe it was a God-given dream, maybe it was another dream, and you wake up almost like in a cold sweat? Or if you've ever had a dream, if you're married, like your spouse did or said something, you wake up and you're all mad about it, and they're like, what did I do? I didn't even do anything. But you dreamt it because it felt so real. Well, that's how this king felt. He was so disturbed by this dream, but he wanted to make sure that nobody was just kind of telling him whatever. You see, so what he said, he called together all of his magi, and he wanted them not to just interpret the dream for them. He wanted them to be able to tell him, this is what you dreamt. That way he knew that they weren't fooling him. So it says this. In Daniel chapter 2, verses 1 through 2, it says, in the second year of his reign, Nebuchadnezzar had dreams. His mind was troubled and he could not sleep. So the king summoned the magicians. See where we're getting there? enchanters, sorcerers, and astrologers to tell him what he had dreamed. So the Magi are a part of this. So he set before them an extraordinary test. No one had ever asked him, asked this of the Magi, a magistrate or a magistrate before. He wanted to be certain that they weren't fooling him, that they weren't tricking him, that they couldn't just interpret it, that they knew what it was. He wanted to know and be certain of the interpretation, because if he felt that if he told it, it told him something about the future. You see, and it did, because this is a dream from God. Well, if we jump ahead to verses 11 to 13, here's what the Magi said. What the king asks is too difficult. No one can reveal it to the king except the gods, and they do not live among humans. You see, the Persians did not worship God. This made the king so angry and furious that he ordered the execution of all of the wise men of Babylon. Like, no more Magi. So the decree was issued to put the wise men to death, and men were sent to look for Daniel and his friends to put them to death, because Daniel was included in this group. So here we meet Daniel. Daniel was called in as a Magi and was able to tell the king's dream and interpret it. And he described a statue in his dream. And this is what it says. It says, Daniel chapter 2, verses 31 to 48. You looked, O king, and there before you stood a large statue. And I'm going to have that statue on the screen. An enormous, dazzling statue, awesome in appearance. The head of the statue was made of pure gold. Its chest and arms of silver, its belly and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, and its feet partly of iron and partly of baked clay, like pottery clay. While you were watching, a rock was cut out, but not by human hands. It struck the statue on its feet of iron and clay and smashed them. Then the iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver, and the gold were broken into pieces at the same time and became like chaff on a threshing floor in the summer. The wind swept them away without leaving a trace. But the rock that struck the statue became a huge mountain and filled the whole earth. This was the dream, and now we will interpret it to the king. You, O king, are the king of kings. Now, he's not talking about Jesus here, but he is an emperor. He's a king over kings. The God of heaven has given you dominion and power and might and glory. All of your authority, that's from God, buddy. Verse 38, in your hands, he has placed mankind and the beasts of the field and the birds of the air. Wherever they live, he has made you ruler over all. He's talking about the glory of this emperor, which was actually very, very true. He's an amazing king, amazing ruler. He says, you are that head of gold. He's the head in the statue. So Nebuchadnezzar's probably feeling kind of cool. After you, verse 39, another kingdom will rise. That doesn't sound great. Inferior to yours, just like silver is inferior to gold. Next, a third kingdom, one of bronze, will rule over the whole earth. And finally, there will be a fourth kingdom, strong as iron, for iron breaks and smashes everything. And as iron breaks things to pieces, so it will crush and break all others. Just as you saw, the feet and toes were partly of baked clay and partly of iron. So this will be a divided kingdom, yet it will have some of the strength of iron in it, even as you saw iron mixed with clay, and his toes were partly iron and partly clay. So this kingdom will be partly strong and partly brittle. And just as you saw the iron mixed with baked clay, so the people will be a mixture and not remain united any more than iron mixes with clay. In the time of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed, nor will it be left to another people. It will crush all those kingdoms. See how it's, that's the rock, you guys, and bring them to an end, but it itself will endure forever. That's where it's like growing into a mountain. That's what that means. This is the meaning of the vision of the rock cut out of the mountain, but not of human hands, a rock that broke the iron and bronze and clay and silver and gold to pieces. The great God has shown the king what will take place in the future. The dream is true and the interpretation is trustworthy. Then King Nebuchadnezzar fell prostrate before Daniel and paid honor to him and ordered that an offering and incense be presented to him. The king said to Daniel, surely your God, now he's talking about God, is the God of gods and the Lord of kings and the revealer of mysteries, for you are able to reveal this mystery. Now listen to this, verse 48. Then the king placed Daniel in a high position and lavished many gifts on him. He made him ruler over the entire province of Babylon and placed him in charge of all of its wise men. Now, we don't want to get into the whole vision a whole lot because that's going to deter from this whole idea of wise men. Many theologians believe, as the Bible even says, Babylon is the head of gold. The next, chronologically, the next empire that comes through is Alexander the Great, and they think that the chest of gold represents the Greek Empire, the belly of bronze is the Roman Empire, the legs of iron would be, the Medo-Persian Empire, then the Roman Empire, and then the last one is a mixture of all other kingdoms that's no longer powerful anymore, and that's when they get smashed by Christ's kingdom moving forward. And you can see in the statue there's some interpretation of what that may look like. But what's interesting here is that Daniel was placed over all these other magi, and that's really what's significant that we want to focus on here, and I don't want to preach a whole other sermon on Daniel right now. But you see, Daniel's prophecy was about the coming King Jesus. That's the mountain. That's the kingdom that will last forever and ever, which is prophesied multiple times in the Bible. The Old Testament would have just referred to him as the Messiah, the anointed one, the king that would come, never pass away. And as Daniel was elevated among the Magi in the Persian kingdom, he began a legacy of Advent then and there, that waiting with expectation for the coming of the Messiah, the coming of that king in the dream. You see, he created a time of hope and expectation for the king and the kingdom that would never be destroyed. And then 600 years later, you want to talk about a long Advent season. That's about how many years Daniel lived before Christ was born. Magi, astronomers, philosophers, mathematicians, scientists, the Magi who came from the east, from Persia. And many believe were students of the school that Daniel had started. They continued to study the stars in expectation of the prophetic dream that their chief, Daniel, foretold and interpreted when they saw a star in the east. Well, they saw a star. They were in the east. The star would have been west of them. Some astronomers today think that it was Jupiter moving with other planets or stars. Some believe it was a cosmic event that has never been seen before. Either way, God showed them some sort of cosmic anomaly that they knew that it meant king and Jerusalem or Judah. So that's where they went. So let's talk about the arrival of the Magi. Let's go back to Matthew. Now, I know many manger scenes have Magi there, but I hate to break it to you. They were likely not there when Jesus was born in the manger. The shepherds would have been there. Animals would have been there. Joseph and Mary would have been there, but that would have been about it. It's more likely that they saw the star in Persia when Jesus was born. And this is the whole conversation that Herod said, well, what time did you see the star? And we're going to time this all out. And that's what we're going to use to figure out how to destroy the boys because I'm worried and I don't want them to take my kingdom away and all that stuff. Jesus was likely almost 2 years old by the time that they had arrived in their journey, because as we read in verse 16 of Matthew chapter 2, Herod tried to kill all the boys that were about 2 years old and younger. They would have needed to gain approval, the Magi. They would have seen the star, but then they got to go talk to their king and say, well, we want to do this and get provisions and then take the journey, which is not short. And they probably would have gone with a large entourage because they're going, hey, we want to go honor this king in another land. And you don't do that just like, hey, I'm going to go bring you a casserole. You come with an entourage to do that. And when they arrived in Bethlehem, they came to a house, not a manger. And they saw a child. That word in Greek is padion. It's not a baby. That word in Greek is brephos. They saw a child, not a baby. And this is why we think, the Magi probably weren't there when Jesus was born. They're not in a manger. They're in a house. It takes you a long time to get there to begin with. And then on top of that, it's not a baby anymore. It's probably a toddler. Herod later attempted to assassinate the child, issuing an order to kill all the male children 2 years old and younger, as we saw in verse 16, and I mentioned that. King Herod is a vassal king also. We need to understand that. He is a king that is subject to an empire. You see, an emperor, the difference between a king and emperor, a king is over a dominion, an emperor is over kingdoms in the plural. And so he is a vassal king, which means he's subject to the Roman emperor at the time. And there are now magistrates, magi, from the neighboring superpower of Persia who show up, which is an enemy of Rome, and they're on Herod's footsteps looking for a king. Can you think now why Herod would have been afraid? He is a small kingdom that's very insignificant on the border between the Roman Empire and the Persian Empire. And here's his itty-bitty-bitty kingdom. And he's subject to Rome, but then come an entourage, probably, of wise men magistrates from the neighboring kingdom, which is an enemy, saying, where's the king? Yes, this is why Herod is freaking out. You would probably be freaking out too, actually. An entourage like that would not have just been three people on camels. Yes, there were three gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. But the likelihood that there were only three men is very small. In fact, the Bible never says how many men there were. Even some church traditions, they like have them named too. The Bible is silent on that. We don't know. The likelihood of three men, though, probably not. But yes, there were three gifts. The Bible is actually silent about several of these issues. But Herod's response demonstrates something probably a lot bigger. So speaking of that, let's talk about these three gifts. Gold. This is a prophetic response. Gold is a tribute worthy of a king. They recognize the kingship of Jesus. Frankincense, which is the NIV, as I read, just said incense, and it is an incense. It's a special kind of incense, very costly incense. It's actually an incense that's mentioned in Exodus chapter 30, verse 34. You see, because it doesn't just recognize Jesus' kingship, it recognizes Jesus' divinity. You see, as God, they honored him when they bowed down to worship him with this incense, recognizing his divinity, because it was included as part of the worship to God when sacrifices were to be offered. That's why it's mentioned there. And then myrrh is prophetic because it's an embalming agent of Jesus' death. You see, because the whole reason, and I've preached this before at the beginning of our Advent series, the entire reason of Jesus coming and being born was to fulfill the prophecies of ending the sacrificial system. He came to die for you and for me. And they recognize that. In fact, myrrh is used. It's mentioned in John chapter 19, 38 to 42. Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, two rabbis, used it to wrap Jesus' body. This was a prophetic response of what Jesus was and came to do. He was a king, the gold. He was God, the frankincense. And he came to die for you and me, the myrrh. As I close, I want us to reflect on this final Advent story. You see, it was 6 centuries in the making. We have a hard time waiting 30 seconds for the drive-through. They were patient. And I want to emphasize that patience, because that patience is hope married with expectation. That hope of the Magi. And they knew that they passed down for generations waiting for this. And they knew that there was something special about Jesus. They recognized his divinity. They recognized his purpose in coming to die. And they did everything to seek him and find him. It was not an easy trip. And the good news for us, the gospel for us, which is what good news means, is that we don't have to wait for Jesus anymore. You don't have to wait. We don't have to seek him like the Magi did. Because he is right here. God is omnipresent. It's a big theology word that means he is everywhere, always. So my question is, does our excitement for Jesus match that of the Magi? Are we passionate about seeking him with all of our hearts? When we sing, do we worship him with excitement and hope and expectation, or is it just a routine? When you sing those Christmas carols, and I'm not talking about Jingle Bells and Rudolph, I'm talking about, oh, come let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Is that a tradition for you, or is that you and your heart seeking your Savior? Because that was the heart of the person who wrote it. Just like regular Christmas shopping, which our family actually did last night. Just like routine of putting up our manger scenes, just like our routine of setting up our Christmas trees, just like the lights we put on our houses and around them, we can create traditions, and traditions are good, but if they lose their significance, they lose their power, and they are absolutely and utterly meaningless. So as we celebrate this year, I want to encourage you. Let us not forget the hunger that Advent brings. Let us not forget the waiting with expectation that the Magi showed us. Let the excitement build because your God came to this earth to save you. He came to die for you, and he came because he loves you.